very great interest nowadays, and that is on preservation of the pulmonary valve in tetralogy and all the techniques. This is a very important topic for the next generation of surgeons who are going to do tetralogies. So to talk on that will be Dr. Hari Bipin, who is a young consultant with us, and he'll be talking on pulmonary valve preservation in tetralogy.
Hello, everybody. Thank you all for coming for this CME. You heard from the masters about replacement, restoration, and the Ross procedure. Actually, this should have come first, I think, but it's just in interest of time that we have mixed up the sequence. So I'll be speaking on pulmonary valve preservation techniques. I won't take much time in the interest of the program getting delayed, and I prepared this talk basically for the students, so it's a very basic talk. First of all, like I clarified, it's preservation and not restoration. And by preservation, it means what you do at the initial repair and not on subsequent repairs. It is to preserve the native pulmonary valve that the child has. So at the outset, it is very important to know that when we operate on tetralogy and we go in with the mindset of preserving the pulmonary valve, it is very essential that you use practical wisdom and clinical experience, because the truth is there are some patients who will require a transannular patch, and there is no hard and fast rule that you have to avoid a transannular patch at all costs. That is one mentality that I think you should have, and you should go in with an open mind even if you are trying to preserve the pulmonary valve. Even the STS data, which came out in 2010, says that despite contemporary awareness of the late consequences of pulmonary insufficiency ventriculotomy with transannular patch, ventriculotomy with transannular patch remains the most prevalent technique in their data, both for primary repair and for repair following palliation. Because we try to avoid TAP, basically because we all know the long-term deleterious effects of transannular patch. And it's in two ways. Basically, the transannular patch causes chronic pulmonary regurgitation, which causes RV dilatation, RV diastolic dysfunction, RV fibrosis, tricuspid regurgitation, arrhythmias, end-stage LV function. And it also, if you put in a large patchless patch, causes an energy sink and takes the wind out of the RV in the long run. So this is just a joke, okay? So when we go in with the mindset of conserving the or preserving the pulmonary valve, the first thing we look for is the Z-score of the pulmonary valve. And we are very concerned if it is less than -2. But we should always remember that -2 is supposed to be the normal. And if the Z-score is -4, you just have to bring the annulus up to -2 to achieve preservation of the pulmonary valve. And I always say this sign, where we look at the baby with tetralogy and look at his thigh creases. And I used to joke that the number of creases on the thigh of the infant is the minus Z-score value of the pulmonary valve. Because if you have 2.5 creases, it is more than -2.5, definitely. So Z-score of the pulmonary valve, coming to that. Kirkland has, this is Jim Kirkland. He has said that lesser PV pulmonary valve Z-scores always correlate with a higher postoperative RV to LV pressure ratio. And there have been various studies on what is the acceptable Z-score. So if it is more than -2, it is okay for preserving the valve, is what initial authors used to say. But now we have reports of Z-scores of up to even -3 and even -4 being conserved with not a transannular patch. And there was one guy who presented at the 2013 AATS meeting pulmonary valve with a very low Z-score, and one patient had a Z-score of -7 in that. So we look at the Z-score on the pre-op echo, but echo is not the gospel truth there, because it is fallacious and it informs only the annulus size. It only gives you a rough idea of whether the pulmonary annulus is small or not, because it doesn't tell you about the effective orifice, it doesn't tell you about the valve morphology or the repairability of the valve. So Z-score is a part of the overall picture, but intraoperative inspection of the valve is very important. And you need to constantly think in terms of valve morphology and not the size of the valve. So by valve morphology, if it is a bicuspid pulmonary valve, there are two things that can happen. You can have a valve which is in the anteroposterior orientation, or you can have a lateral orientation. Of this, the first one is the better option, because it is possible to enlarge the sinuses easily if the valve is in the anterior posterior orientation. You can even cut across the commissure and leave the valve leaflets instead of enlarging. But in the lateral orientation, you can cut the anterior cusp, but cutting the posterior cusp to enlarge is a little difficult, and sometimes it might lead to catastrophes. But people have tried to do that, go behind the pulmonary artery and try to enlarge the posterior also. So that's why I said practical wisdom is very important. If you think that it is too much of a job, it is better to do a transannular patch. So we have this in our OR, and we just have a look at the wall when we are operating on a tetralogy and try and match the body surface area with the effective mean orifice, which is minimum acceptable for that child. So the aim is to reach at least 2 millimeters less than the ideal orifice size. And this was mentioned by Emil Bacha, who has done a lot of work on this. And it came out in this issue of the seminars, 2017, that the aim should be to reach at least 2 millimeters less than the ideal orifice size. So the principles of preserving the valve, the principles of operation, basically it is to preserve pulmonary valve function and to allow for future somatic growth. And the idea should be to relieve all supra and subvalvar stenosis. Because at the end of surgery, the only stenosis that should be acceptable is the stenosis at the annular level. So how do we achieve this? There are 4 basic principles. You have to open the main pulmonary artery, because it is much easier to see the pulmonary valve from the main pulmonary artery than from the RV outflow. You have to make a small incision right below the pulmonary annulus on the RV outflow. Now this depends on if there is an anomalous coronary or not, but if it's not there, it has to be as close to the annulus as possible. And you have to do a detailed analysis of pulmonary valve and sinus anatomy in respect of number of cusps, number of commissures, cusp plane. Especially you have to identify the anterior cusp. So we follow an algorithm based approach. I think most units who are doing tetralogy routinely should have this. And it should be passed on to all the surgeons, because they should all do the same thing, the anesthesiologist, the cardiologist, everybody should be in the picture and on the same wavelength. So for milder forms of tetralogy, we try to do a total transatrial repair. There's no ventriculotomy, no pulmonary arteriotomy. Small RV outflow patch with no pulmonary arteriotomy for the next. Then we try to do a small outflow patch with pulmonary arteriotomy and a commissurotomy at the most. Then the next more severe variety is small RV outflow patch with a pantaloon patch. Or we try to put an MPA patch. And we have done intraoperative balloon dilatation in a few patients as well. And if nothing works, the idea should be to put a small transannular patch. And I stress on the word small. The transannular patch does not need to be a very big one. You just have to cut across the annulus, go down a few millimeters. This, again, in the seminars this year, the pediatric cardiac surgery annual, it has come as an algorithm-based approach by Emil Bacha. So for all patients, they should be limited infundibulectomy. They should be commissurotomy of pulmonary valve till the medial layer of the wall. The MPA longitudinal incision and patch augmentation of sinuses, sometimes even the posterior sinuses, depending on your skill, should be done. For mild to moderate PS with mildly dysplastic valves, you might have to do additionally a commissurotomy of the pulmonary valve and gentle dilatation of the Hagar with a Hagar dilator. You should not thrust it in, that's the word he uses there. You should not thrust the Hagar dilator inside. It should be gentle graded dilatation. For moderate pulmonary stenosis with dysplasia, you can do all of the above, plus intraoperative static balloon dilatation. And this is now a large series in Boston Children's, where they started doing this and now other units are doing this as well. And this is especially good for patients in whom you want to avoid a transannular patch at all cost, like for example with an anomalous large coronary crossing the RV outflow. And the last thing is, he has come up with something called as a valve-sparing transannular reconstruction, where if it's an anterior cusp, it is divided in the midline and then it is augmented with a patch in the coronal plane. But the hinge points of the cusp and leaflet are kept intact in the hope that when you are doing a future restoration of the valve, it will be helpful. So this is what they mean by their algorithmic approach. Every patient gets pulmonary arteriotomy and RV incision. for doing this, it is essential that the branch pulmonary arteries should be well mobilized. The ligamentum or the ductus should be divided. If you have to do this technique, you have to mobilize the branch pulmonary arteries in every tetralogy and divide the ligamentum. You can do a commissurotomy, which is demonstrated here. You can do static balloon dilation, all stepwise. And this is the latest, a valve-sparing transannular patch, where you cut the anterior cusp and then augment it with a patch. And the shape of the patch is like this. And there are measurements mentioned in the article. You can go through that, please. And then that patch and the transannular patch comes over this. So this acts as the... It's not exactly like a monocusp, because in the monocusp, the hinge point is here. Here, the patch is being augmented over here. So it's not exactly a monocusp. This is another picture of the same technique. So when I was at SickKids, they also had an algorithm-based approach for tetralogy. Sometimes it used to have disastrous consequences because they used to do the same thing for every tetralogy, irrespective of the morphology and the clinical findings. So all patients would get a pulmonary arteriotomy, all patients would get commissurotomy and commissural takedown, which is not advised. And they would dilate with a sound, not a Hagar dilator, which is similar to a Hagar, but it has got a flexible tip. And all patients would get a pantaloon patch if it's a bicuspid valve. They would always put an RV outflow patch, and if none of these works, then they would go back and do a transannular patch. So there will be a lot of going on and off pump, checking pressures, doing a TE for all patients of tetralogy. So the pantaloon patch is a very fantastic thing, I feel, to relieve supravalvar PS. And they say there is a 70% success with the pantaloon.